This is WBSM On Demand. It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and it's a Friday morning. It's not my favorite day of the week because it means I'll have 2 days off from you, but I'll be back Monday, God willing. So we're going to carry out the day today. I think we got some really interesting stuff. We've got Chris Markey in here. Today, he'll answer questions as a representative, but he's here as an attorney. Chris spent a number of years in the Bristol County District Attorney's Office as a prosecutor. And now he's a defense attorney. So I brought him in, many of you have heard him before, to talk about the Karen Reed case. I have been following the case like many of you, but I think it's really important to have a experienced prosecutor and defense attorney sort of break it down. He doesn't have any role in this case. So he's a great resource. So if you have any questions specifically about the case, why they're doing certain things or why they're not doing certain things, from a layman's point of view, Chris can answer that, 508-996-0500. Later on, we're going to hear from Amy DiPizio. I'll get it right eventually. Amy from Nantucket. Amy has been fighting the Vineyard Wind. Last night, there was a vote in the Nantucket town meeting that she was very excited about. She's going to give us a call, give us an update on what happened last night in Nantucket Town Meeting. Then at 11 o'clock, we'll have Sheriff Tom Hodgson here in the studio talk about everything related to Donald Trump and the Trump campaign and what's going on here in Massachusetts. So hope you'll enjoy the day. And anytime you want to call in, it's 508-996-0500. Good morning, Chris. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. So give us a breakdown quickly. The Karen Reed trial, what's happening? Where are they now?
Okay. So what's happened over the last few days is that they're just laying the groundwork for how it happened. And it's kind of, at least, I've kept it on in the background at work just to kind of see what's going on.
Sure.
Some of it's pretty boring and ignoring some of it. But it's pretty clear that the prosecutor is setting up every single thing he can possibly do. There's more videotapes being shown than I think it's a lot. And laying the groundwork for what it was like that night.
Okay.
And I think they're doing that and trying to account for every minute because of the nature of the defense. So they're pretty aware of what the defense is going to be, and they're trying to establish every single detail, like they're not hiding anything.
Okay.
And I think that's their theme right now is we're not hiding anything. We're talking about the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I think that gives them some credibility to try to do it, although some of the evidence isn't helpful. Over the time, is they hope that the concept of them hiding evidence or manipulating evidence or this conspiracy theory would be evaporated by the fact that they are they're showing up everything.
Let's explain that for a second, because they have a very unique defense. Without endorsing, explain what the theory of the defense is.
Well, first, there's two things to it. There's one is what we call Bowdoin instruction or Bowdoin case, where the police did not do a proper investigation.
Okay.
And they're kind of mocking them about, you know, the bags that they use, a red Solo cup, you know, all the indications to say that it was a not professional investigation.
Okay.
And that's a legitimate defense on many cases where you can say that the police did not do proper things. The type of bag it was, if it said evidence or it said Stop and Shop, it really doesn't matter in my mind. It's still the evidence.
Yes.
The question is how did the evidence get there? The red Solo cup, it could be anything, but my understanding is it's a snowstorm. you know, you need to protect the evidence, and sometimes you cover it or you do whatever. So okay. you collect it any way you can, the cleanest way possible. So that's those are things that are can be easily marked. But their defense is really a conspiracy on that, and then a third-party culprit, which I believe they're trying to say is one of the Albert's son.
Yes.
And so now they're laying the groundwork to say that one of the troopers involved, who's very close with the Albert family, is protecting this son. And that's where they're laying the groundwork, the communications between the Alberts and the trooper's sister, I think it is, as well as the number of visits they had, how often they communicate, all these things that begin to lay the groundwork for this grand conspiracy theory.
They had to get permission from the judge before they could use this defense. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's typical. It's an affirmative defense that you would have. So you get to provide notice and give the opportunity for the prosecutor to investigate a potential third-party culprit that they believe it is. And you'd have to show that their person had motive, had the intent, and also had the opportunity. So that's what they're trying to establish now. They got to put, I think that what they're going to have to do is somehow put in the son, is it Colin or something? Connor or Colin.
Something.
The son in the house at the time, and then somehow have to get O'Keefe's body into the house. They believe they have forensic phone evidence to suggest that. I don't know. But it'll be interesting to see how that develops.
What I think, I've been shocked by, and you probably haven't been, but we'll talk about it. The amount of cell phone information that both the defense and the prosecution are able to come up with. Is that standard now?
It's routine now for everybody. I think every defense lawyer says to their client when they come in with a case is, let me take your cell phone. I'll do a forensic examination of it. That's like the first thing you do.
Okay.
Just because there's so much information, location information, communication information, searches, things like that that could become relevant, and what do you want to do with it? The DA's office or the prosecutors or the police, they always want access to, because it's more information.
Sure.
And you it's almost routine now that that happens. I mean, I haven't been involved in the murder cases and the investigations, but I assume now it's basically you're on call, there's a murder, and now troopers not only just go to the scene, but they go back to the office where a computer is, and they just start taking in all the information, get search warrants for phones. And you're asking questions now as an investigator: what's your cell phone number? Who's your provider? Where's your cell phone? They want to know all that stuff because they know there's so much information on that.
Chris Markey, defense attorney, what would you tell a future defendant about those questions?
If you pay me, I'll give you the advice. But the other thing is now they're surveillance. You used to do a comb the area and just check and talk to all the neighbors and do that type of canvas, mm-hmm. and try to talk to people. Now you go, the first thing you do is I think you go around and you look for Ring cameras.
All right.
Or any surveillance camera, and you figure out who's got them. And as a defense attorney, you do that as well. You go down and you go, okay, 81 Bedford Street, 72 Grove Street. Okay, well, they have cameras. So at least then you can go back to the police office and go, did you go down Bedford Street? Did you look for cameras? No, I didn't. Then you may be entitled to that Bowden instruction where, hey, they should have gone and looked at that stuff.
Okay.
And then you can make the argument at the end, hey, what's the best evidence is would have been a video, surveillance video. Well, we know at 81 Bedford Street there was one.
Right.
They didn't take it. Why didn't they take it?
We're speaking with Chris Markey, who's a former prosecutor and currently a defense attorney here in Bristol County. Well, I guess all of the counties in Massachusetts. So, Chris, I'm asking this because I bet a lot of people at home are asking it. So how does the defense get access to the Ring cameras? We know how the police do it. They show up and ask, and they can get search warrants. But how does the defense get access to this information?
Well, first, through the discovery process, you assume the police have done that, and they've tried to do that. then they send out investigators and ask for it. We want in a time frame. Sometimes witnesses will cooperate and give it to you. They don't particularly care. They don't have an interest in the case, but they can provide that information. Or you can go up to them through an investigator and just say, hey, when did you get this? Well, if the homicide occurs on April 1st and you've had the cameras up since January 2nd, the police should have known that.
Okay.
So now you can say, well, the police never went to that house.
So that's under that type of defense where they didn't do an adequate investigation.
Yeah. So, and then you could find out that they got it on April 15th, even though the murder happened on April 1st. Doesn't matter. It's not relevant. It's not going to be helpful. So those are the things you send out investigators to try to get that information.
508-996-05 so you can get on the program.
You can also summons in the records through certain rules is get Ring to provide you the information.
Defense can.
Yeah.
And obviously the prosecution can.
Yeah.
And the defense is under an obligation to disclose all the stuff they've done, right?
The prosecutor.
The prosecutor, yeah, I'm sorry.
Yes.
The defense is not.
No.
No. So when it gets into this conspiracy, third party did it type of defense, is the defense required to give that information to the prosecution?
Yes. To a degree, yes.
Okay.
You have to provide certain information. And that's where the big leap is. Like, I could say you did it.
Right.
And then, you know, the police have to go out and try to investigate where was Chris McCarthy on the particular night. But you also have to show that you had the opportunity to do it, and you had a motive to do it, and you had the intent to do it. So there's a whole group of things that the defense still has to overcome. Typically in a criminal case, the burden is entirely on the Commonwealth to do that.
Okay.
There are certain affirmative defenses where there is a burden on the defendant to produce something. And then at that point, there's another hurdle that the Commonwealth will have to overcome.
So did the defense, Karen Reed's defense, in your opinion, based on what you've been able to get publicly from the case, do you think they've delivered some evidence to the judge that makes their theory plausible or possible?
No, I think there's a...
They don't have to do that.
No, they have to do that.
Okay.
But I think this is just one step. You know, you think of it, you could call it a marathon. You could call it going up a flight of stairs, and maybe there's three steps into a 10-stair flight.
Okay.
So it takes some time, and they got to try to put all these little nuggets into it to create something. They still got to have the... From my understanding is, at least the witnesses would say that the son wasn't there. I don't think. I think that was some issue with that. So I don't know how they're going to get the son in the house. And maybe they do it through forensic phone evidence or they do it through something else. That's where you got to... Because if he wasn't at the house, then he wouldn't have had the opportunity.
Correct.
So then that whole defense goes out.
508-996-0500. Chris, my understanding is with a cross-examination, it's not so much the answers... it's the defense or the prosecutor in the cross-examination of witnesses is telling their version of events. Is that what you use it for?
Yeah. On cross, you try to get out, the little nuggets that you can then make an argument at. All you need it in is once. We used to always say, get in, get out. Get the evidence you need and get out. Because then you're the one who's telling the story at the end. You're the one who's making the inferences. You typically don't want to ask why. On cross-examination, you just want to get in them to agree to a series of facts that then you can argue.
Which is painful to the listeners. But you, the defense, or you, the prosecutor, you don't really care about the home audience, do you?
Oh, no, not at all.
No. You have in other words, when you're at home, as I am watching these trials, it's not about me, it's about the jury, right?
Yeah. And it's all, like yesterday I saw a little bit of it and the guy was talking about his cheaters, right? Like he had
reading glasses
and the woman needed to borrow them or something like that. And he starts putting in this extra stuff and he's trying to build a relationship with the jurors. You know, I'm just a normal human guy, you know, all that stuff.
Really?
And, I thought it went a little overboard because I thought he got his point across like in one comment. But he tried to get in and explain like more. And then when he, and again, it's silly stuff, but it's just little trial stuff. And then the judge actually came in and said, no, just give her the glasses.
Really?
You know, and it deflates everything. Yep. So if he just did it once, you know, people get it.
Right.
Those little things.
He was borrowing the glasses?
The witness was borrowing the glasses from him.
Okay.
And he says, oh, I just got them today or last week, whatever. I didn't know how to use them. Like, who doesn't know how to use them? Like, some stupid thing like that.
Okay.
But his intent was to try to create a relationship with a common experience with a juror or two jurors or three jurors and kind of chuckle about something where they've been sitting in the courtroom all day.
All right.
You know, all those are all little trial strategies you do throughout.
Sure. 508-996-0500. We have Chris Markey here in the studio. I'll take your calls. We're talking about the Karen Reed trial specifically. I think it's the biggest trial in America right now.
No, there's another one in New York. Just so you know, as a former president, your guy.
The first president to ever be tried by his political opponent, your guy.
Former president.
Stick around. We'll be right back. Soon to be. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy. We have Christopher Markey here in the studio. Used to be an assistant prosecutor in the Bristol County District Attorney's Office, and he's a defense attorney now. We're taking your calls at 508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Hello?
Hello. Yes, you're on the air.
Hi. What does Chris think about the fact that his shoe wasn't at the scene? I mean, if it happened the way the prosecution said, and he got hit by her and she left, his shoe should be there. If it's not on his foot, it's got to be there. And they never found his shoe. So just wondering what he thinks of that. You can answer off here. Thank you
very much. Thanks for the call. What do you think, Chris?
I think that's one of those things. Is we talk about, you know, those little nuggets of facts that can help with the, I'll call it the conspiracy theory defense. That's just one more of those things that the judge can look at to determine if they're going to go forward with the third party culprit. That's one piece of evidence. There may be some explanation along the way that it can explain it away. I don't know. But I do think that that's one piece of evidence that the defense can rely on to try to get to that third-party culprit defense.
So people at home who are following the trial, they should be looking for what you talked about. There's two defenses here. The conspiracy that he was murdered by somebody else, and they're all the witnesses are covering it up. Or just shoddy police work, which is reasonable doubt, right?
Yeah, both can create that.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what, again, just like every witness, you want to provide one piece of evidence or something, whether it be corroboration, to show your theory of the case. And I think that's why it's kind of painful watching right now when they just have them sitting at a bar drinking, oh, who's drinking that? Who's that person? Or coming back in the car and it's snow. And
I thought at first they were showing the Hugh Dunn trial.
And so they go through that whole process to show, I think, as the prosecutor, to show that they're not hiding anything. And then the defense will start picking away at that. Oh, they look like they were hugging. Oh, they were getting along, all that. And that's great for them because that's another nugget of at least showing it's not a second.
So the defense is telling their own story, and they're trying to get their narrative into the jurors' heads, right?
Yeah, and that's what they do. They're using the Commonwealth's evidence. And this is one of the things that I think when you're a trial lawyer is the most effective evidence is using the evidence that the other side has to your side is the most effective way. Whether it be a defendant's admissions or statements that you can use and then or prove that they're false, all of those things are ways in which you can effectively argue at the end if they're guilty or not guilty.
508-996-0500. If you're following the Karen Reed trial, as we all are, we have Chris Markey here in studio. Chris is a defense attorney. Previous to this, he was a prosecutor in the Bristol County District Attorney's Office. So I think he's really understands this stuff certainly better than I do. Chris, the idea that Karen Reed's defense is accusing police officers, family members of police officers, including a federal agent,
do they have to prove that part of the case for that to be a defense? Or is it just they're trying to, they know there's a dead body, so how do they explain it? Is that what they're trying to do?
No, I think what they're trying to establish is that these are people who are not just, you know, John Jones or Tom Smith out on the street who are just simple people.
Okay. Right?
These are people who, one, have influence over Canton.
Yep.
One, number one, have relationships with law enforcement. Number two, and who's in charge of the investigation is law enforcement. And then you have those investigations. They can be motivated to do things differently. That's basically what their defense is going to say is, this isn't just some Joe Schmo. This is the people who are actually in charge, and there's a conflict, and they're helping out this individual and hiding certain things so that they can blame Karen for the death. It's a big risk.
Yeah.
And there's going to be other evidence. Again, this is only what they, you know, whatever, 2 weeks into it.
Yep.
But you have to look at it in this way. There's going to be evidence. It's probably forensic evidence that's going to be explained by real experts on the phone stuff. You know, you're going to hear all the time, oh, there's a search at 225. There's no way the Commonwealth would not rebut that in some fashion.
Okay.
With a very good expert.
So they're going to be looking for that.
They're going to have a very good expert to explain why the search happened at 625 and not at 225.
This is the search. How long does it take to die in snow?
And they're going to, because one of the witnesses, I presume, is going to say that Karen Reed asked me to search for it. I think that's what has come out, or at least in the press before. So if that happens, that's one thing. Then there's also forensic evidence within the car, right? So there's, in an airplane, we call it the black box or whatever it is.
Right. Those existing cars now,
the question is can you retrieve that information from that time frame? And it would be interesting to know what the black box says in that car. I mean, it may be that there's nothing there, but the Commonwealth would still present an expert to say there isn't anything here and this is the reason why there is nothing here. Or an expert to say there is something here and this is what happened at 12:35.
You and I have talked a lot off the air about this case. How much of it hinges on the medical examiner?
Huge. I think if I were to, you know, this is all intriguing and kind of Dateline crap.
Yeah.
And it's kind of interesting. It catches us. But the case, I think, is going to be really decided on if there's a black box and the experts that go against each other. The cell phone people, the forensic people who will determine when the search was, and then the medical examiner who has to explain how those puncture wounds, and they look like puncture wounds on the arm of O'Keefe.
They're going to have to
explain. And then there's the big gash on the top of the head. So, you know, they could explain that he's bending over, picking up the broken glass that he, I mean, I'm just guessing.
Sure.
Right? So the prosecutor will say, well, he was bending over to picking up the glass that he broke because he's half in the bag.
Right.
And he's picking it up and she's backing up, hits him as he's bent over, cracks his head, and then he falls onto the glass.
Ah.
Who knows? But then you got to have the clothing, and the clothing has to have some holes in it as well. And I don't know. There's a million things that could be the reason why, but I just don't know.
But the defense,
they'll have their own expert as well. Medical examiner is going to say that this is consistent with what they believe is to be a dog bite. This,
and there is a missing dog.
Yeah, yeah. These are all nuggets that play into it. The question still comes back to opportunity, and has the defense created enough evidence to suggest that this guy had the actual opportunity to do it?
How much does the judge's instructions to the jury play into it?
It's huge. It's huge. At the end of the case, the defense will get up and argue why they believe she's not guilty, and then right after that, the Commonwealth will get up and argue why she is guilty, and then right after that, the judge on a case like this will take about an hour and read the instructions to the jury. One, reasonable doubt, the definition of reasonable doubt, which is agreeing to a moral certainty that the defendant did it, and each and every element to a moral certainty. Then there will be the Bowdoin instruction, which will highlight the police failures. And then I'm sure the defense will have spent a great deal of time on that. And then if they establish the third-party culprit, the defense will have established that and then use the same language in their closing that the judge is going to use.
Okay.
And the prosecutor will talk about some of the stuff for trying to prove a second-degree murder. They may not even get to that point. I still don't see this as a second. I don't even know if it would get to the jury as a second because I just don't know if there's enough
What do you see evidence. It as?
I see it as a motor vehicle homicide, OUI, and leaving the scene of a homeless homicide.
Okay.
So that's like a 2.5 in the house, 1 year to serve, something like that.
Why didn't, well, is that something her lawyers could have argued early on or should have argued early on?
I think that's what we do in a plea negotiation.
Okay.
So I guess it didn't happen.
Right.
So it's a big risk. For her, because it's life.
But right.
Parole eligibility is in 15 years.
That's a lot of Christmases in Framingham.
Potentially.
Yeah. 508-996-0518. Some people on hold. Good morning. Thank you for holding.
Yeah, good morning, Chris.
What's
good
happening?
Morning, Representative Markey.
Hi.
You know, the special prosecutor has a lot of power. With the judge, they can determine what is or what isn't admissible in court. Which, let's say the defense has a good case and the judge throws it out. It's not good for the defendant. Can you elaborate on that, please?
Thanks for the call.
In this case, there's no special prosecutor. It's just a regular prosecutor who's involved in the case. So usually a special comes in when there's a conflict between the DA's office and a party or that. Secondly is that the judge... every judge in every case makes a determination as to the relevancy, and which means that essentially is this piece of evidence going to assist the jury in making a decision as to the ultimate issue in the case? And those are determinations that a qualified judge would make. That I don't think a judge is at the point where they could just ignore what the defense is doing. I mean they'd get reversed and There'd be issues with that.
Okay.
So there's always that opportunity for an appeal if there is something that is done way out of whack.
Have you seen anything like that yet?
No. Now I think everything that's happened so far is expected. At least in my mind, that the prosecutor will slowly go through a boring night, what appeared to be a boring night at first, and try to explain every second of every moment of John O'Keefe's moments before. And explain every second of every detail of what Karen Reed was doing before. And then with that comes some baggage, right? Some things that aren't going to help them.
Okay.
One is that they're hugging and kissing and they're getting along and they're doing those things. That doesn't help their theory. But it does help explain the bigger idea that they're not hiding anything.
Okay.
So those are the things that I would say that it's very, what's happened so far I've expected.
508-996-0. Stick around. We'll be right back and take a quick break. Welcome back. I'm Chris McCarthy. We're covering the Karen Reed trial. It's going on up in Norfolk County with Chris Markey, who is a defense attorney and a state representative here in Dartmouth and New Bedford, but also a former prosecutor for the Bristol County District Attorney's Office. I think there's really no better person to discuss the case with my audience. So 508-996-0500. What I was getting at off the air, Chris, is that what is happening here is so interesting to me, because the idea that someone could die at your house and then you could end up being accused of murder by the person who's been arrested for the crime is mind-boggling to me.
Yeah, but they're taking their best defense, what they believe to be their best defense.
In other words, they have some proof that points in the theory of their case. This is not totally out of whole cloth.
There's no one who's going to come in and say, yes, this kid did it, right? So the only way to do it is through reasonable inferences. And the only way you get through reasonable inferences is facts in which can reasonably infer that X happened.
Okay.
So they're trying to produce that. They're trying to build a picture where all these people are super tight. The witness who's on the stand now and the trooper's sister are super tight. They're talking to each other all the time. They're texting back and forth, all of that stuff. Why would that happen? And why would that trooper then be involved in this case where the person died on their front lawn or in their house, whatever it is? But that raises some suspicion. The prosecutor is trying to do his best now to get rid of that. Then you go into the puncture wounds. Then you go into the search. Then you go through the phone records. All of those things begin to lay the groundwork for them to try to do that. And, you know, one could say that that's a reasonable inference at the end. Now, the question is can they get to that point? And what I would say maybe counter defense does the prosecutor have? And it's going to come back to the quality of experts that they have for the phones, the searches, the medical examiner, and any forensic type evidence that they need to rely on, whether it be the DNA people as well. So it all of that will matter.
508-996-04. I have a question. You can probably bat it right down with a very simple answer, but I noticed that she brought in one lawyer from California. How does that work? Karen Reed.
People have lawyers from all over that come in and do that. I don't think that much of it.
Do you work under someone else's license?
He could be. He could be licensed in Mass. I just don't know that. But he could be working under someone else's license.
So that's no big deal.
No. Yeah. I mean, it's not. I mean, there's personally, I think there's plenty of really good lawyers in Massachusetts.
That's correct. I do too.
But that's her choice, and that's not a problem.
Yeah. Is it a problem for him, rules of evidence, anything like that, or is it basically all uniform across the country?
It's all different a little bit, but it's not, ironically, Massachusetts doesn't have a codified set of rules. They use all cases, and it's kind of archaic, but it's really one of the only places, yeah. But most places have the rules of evidence that are consistent with what Massachusetts has.
508-996-05. We're talking about the Karen Reed case. It's in Norfolk County. It's the murder. John O'Keefe was a Boston police officer. It's kind of funny. I think we've gotten so far into the trial that we've gotten away from John O'Keefe, the victim.
Yeah.
Right? His brother was on the stand last week, I think it was. They're talking about the relationship. Is the prosecutor saying she intentionally ran him over as opposed to it just happened and she didn't know it?
Well, I would assume there's different theories. There are different theories of second-degree murder, and I assume from that he would be picking one of the, what I would call the third potential prong of motor vehicle, of murder, which is that she intended to do an act that would cause grievous, serious harm, and there's a substantial likelihood that death would result. I assume that that's what their that the prosecutor's theory is. Not like,
and they already have the black box, right?
They would have that early on.
So what would be something, you make an assumption here, but what would be on that black box that would point in the theory of that, for instance?
Well, first, it depends on the model and make of the car. Is it a first generation black box or a second generation black box? And is it like a newer car? Does it have the ability and capabilities of recording for hours before? Does it have it only it rewinds every 5 seconds, every 10 seconds, so it gets the last few seconds of the car being operated. Okay. I don't know what will be there, but I would be looking for, one is to see if she was backing up at approximately the time, how far she was backing up, and the speed she was backing up at. All of that.
So both the prosecutor and the defense have that now?
Yes.
So, as you pointed to, that's a major situation.
Yeah, that would be huge.
Right.
I mean, if the idea
she was backing up 70 miles an hour in a driveway for 10 feet, that is reckless and...
Well, it's first off, it's impossible to go 70 miles an hour in 10 feet. But with that, like if you go, she's driving 30 miles an hour backwards for 80 feet at 12:30 in the morning, there's something there, right? That's a pretty good piece of evidence for the Commonwealth. Now, the defense may say that there's some explanation for that or whatever. Try to explain away how long their driveway is, all that. Whatever it is.
Sure.
There's a million things that they could try to explain. But the thing about that is that would be consistent with the theory that the Commonwealth had. And I would assume that the black box wasn't taken prior to her being her initial arrest in the district from the district court.
That's interesting.
So if they already had that belief that she backed up, and hit him, and then they got the black box to corroborate that, that's pretty compelling evidence for the government. But can they get that? I don't know.
508-996-05. Get some people on hold. Good morning. Thank you for holding.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hello.
Hi. Now I just lost my train of thought. The dog bites on his arms, why would that be? That's because they were maybe arguing inside the house, and they were pretty well intoxicated, all of them, right?
So, first thing is
good question. Thanks.
You're presuming that they're dog bites, and that's one of the first things that you have to understand is they got to establish that they're dog bites. The first person who would testify as to the cause of death will be the Commonwealth medical examiner, and he or she, I think it's a she, would say those puncture wounds are consistent with falling on glass or are consistent with such and such. On cross-examination, I'm sure the defense attorney will get them to say it could be consistent with some type of bite. Now, depending on who you believe and how it comes out, you can't just assume that it's going to be dog bite. So that's kind of the problem with the case for the Commonwealth is there are going to be reasons why there's a puncture wound. I call it a puncture wound and not a dog bite. And then how come there's a blunt force trauma on the top of the head? Those things will be essential when it comes down to the case at the end and what the jurors decide.
So someone texted me this question. Can you ask how the FBI findings that John O'Keefe couldn't have died from a strike of a car factor into this?
I don't know. I don't know if that will even come out. And I don't know how that would go because it is a decision by a third party that is not a witness to the case. And I don't know if the defense attorneys will be calling anyone from the FBI to come to that conclusion. They may use their expert to talk about that.
Okay.
But the conclusion or the decision of somebody else's opinion is never going to come in because that's ultimately for the jury to decide. So I couldn't come in and say, I've come to the conclusion that he died this way. You'd have to have the evidence first produced. And if they produce the evidence via the FBI expert, they can do that.
So they would have to subpoena the FBI in.
Yeah. But the finding itself of the FBI coming to that conclusion is irrelevant. It's their belief. Yeah. It's the person who would come to the decision as to this is how it happened.
So the FBI's expert.
Yeah.
Oh, that's an interesting distinction. So yes, it would be they can call in the medical examiner from the FBI?
Yeah, or whoever they use.
Whoever they use. And they know who it is.
Yeah.
That's interesting. That's very interesting. Folks, stick around. We're going to be right back. We'll take a quick break. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy. Chris Markey, we have just enough time for you to say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Really appreciate you coming in to talk about this case. What should we look forward to?
Yeah, I'm happy to do it. It's a pretty interesting case.
I think it's
it's one of those cases where I think at the end of every day, you go back as whether you're the prosecutor or the defense is, hey, did we win today? And then on Friday afternoon, did we win this week? And then that's how you determine it.
The presumption of innocence is so overwhelming. Most people on the jury keep that in mind?
Yeah, well,
You hope, right?
You know, beyond a reasonable doubt is the thing that really makes kind of an even playing field.
Okay.
With this is that, you know, you have the power of the government and the ability to investigate and the tools that they have against an individual.